I'm tired of myself, I'm tired of this town.
We're actually live right now, huh?
We're supposedly live.
Wow, this is a really good introduction.
We didn't do the music.
Eminent Waste of Time live.
Episode 93. Yeah, look at that.
I'm Doug.
And I'm Chad.
It's been a while.
It's been a long while since Doug and I have been together on a show. So special guest Doug, who you've seen before, and now you're seeing again. Yes, Steve, who the heck is that? So so the background is definitely different here.
We're not at a brothel. That's not why. No. It's red curtains everywhere.
I do have red curtains in my den. I did that because they block more light. That's the only reason.
Actually, I think I was with you at Walmart. Yeah. When we bought them, because we were trying to play video games.
Yeah.
It was too much light coming in, so it was important stuff.
Yeah, so red curtains it was. And it's kind of the reasoning. So we're in my den. We can see all your guys' comments. I have it up on my TV up there, so we're watching what you're saying, and we can respond.
And if it's inappropriate, we won't read it.
That is very true.
Yes, Michael Plank. It is me.
Yep. It's very much the Doug.
I know there'd probably been some rumors out there that maybe I'd died in some sort of Chad-related accident, but
ha-ha.
Rumors of my demise are greatly exaggerated.
Very true. So, let's...
Well, it hasn't been that long, Barry.
Yeah, Doug is... He's not dead. He's not gotten much, much older. Dude, the cats are already trying to break in.
So, we have a guitar amp sitting against the doors because the doors to Chad's man cave here don't really latch.
No, they're kind of those spring ones.
And it's like a French door style.
Yeah.
And so, we've got a guitar amp sitting against the door to keep the cats out. And if they get in past that, this could be a very interesting podcast.
Cats suddenly, like, attacking us.
Throwing themselves at the doors like zombies. Yeah,
they will, actually.
No, that's fantastic.
So, anyway...
Yes, I have aged a lot, namely because I'm still your friend.
Yeah.
It's hard on a guy.
I'm not that old, although I look that old. I have aged myself.
No. I'm actually 6 days older than you. Yes. So. Brad, he's got two cats. They're just not in here because I am wicked crapping allergic to cats. In fact, earlier, one of them scratched my foot and it's already swelled up into this nice little welt.
Yeah.
And I mean, not like scratched, it drew blood, just like a very light, you know, across the surface of my skin. And yeah.
Guitar solo. No, guitars are hanging on the wall. I just.
We don't want to decrease viewership.
Yeah. How was vacation? I guess I'll start with that. That's a
you
simple.
You do love Florida.
I hate Florida. I absolutely hate Florida with a passion. Florida is the armpit of the United States. I have said it to several people, and I really do mean it. I don't like Florida.
You know, I'm going to let you tell your story, but honestly, from us chatting back and forth and texting and stuff, this really could have been like a National Lampoon's type of movie, just the mishaps and the stupidity.
Which story are you referring to? Because
just the fact that you got down there, and even though your mother-in-law had been to this place many times, gave you the wrong address,
yeah,
and you ended up in this little tiny pickup truck that didn't really fit the family, especially your ginormous son.
Yeah.
And.
So, I flew to Florida. We had an early, early morning flight. I think, the flight was supposed to leave at 6:15, which is early because you have to be at the airport 2 hours prior to boarding. So we get there, or we wake up, and I get an email saying, oh, your flight's delayed by an hour. Well, it's like, I'm already up, so I'm not going to go back to bed now. I'm already up, and it's 3 a.m. So we finally get down there. I was supposed to have an F-150 rented, crew cab. Well, it's F-150 or similar comparable vehicle, whatever they say.
And you got something completely comparable.
I got a Dodge Ram, and my gosh, that truck sucked. So Dodge, for those,
this segment brought to you by
Dodge. It's a Ram truck. Sorry. But for those of you that don't know and haven't been in the 2019 Ram 1500 trucks, they've gone back to the stupid short doors. They don't have the long doors like they went back to with Ford and all that last couple of years. Now they're cutting corners and cutting some of that steel out. So there is hardly any room. I was telling Doug about it. And if I put the front driver's seat where I would normally drive, my hand, the width of my hand, just like from knuckle to knuckle, not including my thumb spread out, but...
Now we can't see the comments, though.
Yes, we can.
Oh.
Mouse go. I had my mouse nervous.
As long as we don't move or breathe.
Or whatever.
Okay, it's staying.
We going?
Yep. People are filtering back in.
Hey, welcome back, guys. Thanks, Facebook.
Eminent Waste of Time, presented by CW Motorsports, episode 93, take two.
Again. It's going to be very delayed.
Us. Hi, Brad.
So,
yeah, the comments will be a little bit delayed. We ended up having to go to the cell phone because reasons?
Because Facebook Live sucks when you do it from a laptop, and yeah, that sucks. So, anyway, back to my story.
So we're watching ourselves live.
We're watching ourselves
like
live up
15
bit.
Seconds off.
Yeah, it's very strange. Okay. So I had to turn the volume down. So anyway, what we had going on with the Dodge truck, so it's very small. And then on top of that, the new Dodge has the, I want to save gas, so I shut my engine off at stoplights and such, like when you come to a stop. So it's still in drive, you just come up there and it shuts itself off. Well, I didn't know that at first. Hey, look, the wife just joined. Hey, the wife. So we come up to the first stoplight and we stop, and all of a sudden the truck like lurches a little bit. Not horrible, but it just lurches a little bit. And I'm like, something that was strange.
No more than a normal Dodge?
Yeah, no more than a normal Dodge. Sorry, but I thought, you know, something happened. Whatever. So we get up to the next stoplight after I take off and everything, and it kind of lurches again. I'm like, did I get rear-ended? And I'm looking around me and trying to figure this out. No, okay. The third stoplight, like, it does it again. I'm looking down. That shows there's no RPMs. No, Steve, we are not letting the cats in.
No.
I figure out that it, you know, shuts itself off. I'm like, oh, okay, whatever. That wasn't a problem until I kind of had this happen that... So it had shut itself off. Well, I had just, I guess, naturally let off the brake a little more to the point that the brakes were holding it from rolling, but not when the engine restarted, and all of a sudden it, like, jumps forward just a little bit, and I'm like, well, I'm glad I wasn't real close to a car, because I would have just rear-ended them. So
nice. So no space, no convenient engine features that aren't stupid.
No, there's other things that I didn't like. When you go to... like turn the radio off because you're going through a drive-thru or something like that, it turns everything on the radio off, which is all your climate control. I mean, it's still working, but you can't control it.
That's kind of an oversight.
Yeah, that was stupid. Just things like that. So
then I gotta say, I'm not a huge fan of the restyle. I liked the previous generation truck. This new one, it just reminds me way too much of a Dodge Caravan.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like a truck.
Yeah. So, and my wife's on, she'll love this. No, my wife says, let the cats in, they're more interesting. Thank you, wife. So my mother-in-law gave us an address. My wife put it in her phone for GPS to get us there. Only that address wasn't a good address or whatever, and it took us a half an hour the wrong direction. And Perfect. We're in like this super sketchy place, and we pull up to this, so much to do shadow puppets. We pull up to this, like, front gate of this place, which did happen to be the same street name and everything as the place we were going. And it was, like, this retirement community. And there's, like, a bunch of trailers from the 70s just over there. And I'm like, this is, like, the ghetto. I don't think we're supposed to be here. This is not it. So
that would have been awesome if that actually was your destination.
So other than that, I mean, the trip was okay. Let's see, what else happened? It was really hot. It's Florida. I didn't go to the pool. I am not a sit-by-the-pool type of person. That's just not me.
Florida in July is just not
Yeah.
Not a good place to be.
So I would take the wife and kids to the pool and drop them off in the morning. At, you know, it wasn't that far, but they didn't want to walk. And at like 9 or 9.30 in the morning, it's 90-something degrees. There's no way I'm going to sit in that.
No.
And it's only getting hotter. We all know that.
So. Yes, Steve Mueller, we lost the mic. If you want, I can hold this.
Yeah, I can hold a mic and make it look like...
It won't help because we're using a cell phone now.
Yeah.
Because it's more stable.
Go figure.
Thanks, Facebook. This is why we can't have nice things. But they're not doing anything, so forget that.
So
you had a great vacation. You came back rested and
raring
to go.
We went to Hollywood Studios, the Disney Hollywood Studios park, the night before. They have like an after hours thing from 7 p.m. to 12:30 p.m. And so we did that. By the time I got back to the room, it was, and in bed, it was 1:30 or 2 in the morning, and I had to get up at 3 for my flight out.
Perfect.
1 hour of sleep and back to the airport. So,
and then I came over to bring your truck back because I have borrowed the truck you actually like, your Ford.
Mm-hmm.
And you were spray painting motorcycle parts.
Yeah.
So
I had my bike tore down, and I was painting it. I'd probably look like a zombie.
I don't know if you've told the fine people that you have a motorcycle again.
So I picked up a 2002 Honda Goldwing, which sounds very strange.
Old Wing, yes,
I did. It was my father-in-law's bike, and he had been trying to sell it for months and months. And finally, I was talking to my wife, and I said, you know, it'd make a good commuter bike. And I could customize it and kind of do some things that I want to do to it. So I didn't tell her dad that I was cutting it up. He was not happy when he found out I was cutting it. I had already cut up his bike.
That's awesome. Well, nope. Cash in hand. It's your bike now.
No, Steve, we're not recording separate audio. We're just going to post this video live.
It's going to be amazing.
So what have I done to this bike? I have cut the tour pack off, which... is kind of odd for Goldwing.
So you look like, what do they call the new Goldwings that come without the tour pack?
It's like the F6B or something like that.
Yeah, it's still got the side bags, right?
Yeah, imagine a Harley Street Glide is kind of the look.
Here you go, yeah.
So I chopped the windshield down. I'm painting it all flat black. It's got the rear rim right now is all black with red pinstripe around it.
I saw that, it looks good.
So, and I'll take it to someone and have like, more pinstriping done on the bags and stuff like that, probably. But so I'm basically making it that, because I took the tour pack off. I had to make electronic solenoids for opening the side bags.
Yes.
So they're on little push buttons now.
Because the tour pack actually has the latches inside it, so if you lose that, then you lose access to the side bags.
That is correct. So
you know what you need? It's got 3-into-3 exhaust on it right now.
Yes, it does.
You need 3-into-1 just complete straight pipe, and should come back and then kick up at a 45-degree angle.
The tracker flappers.
Yes. Just be really obnoxious.
Yes.
Like the worst Goldwing ever.
So, that's kind of what's going on with me. I mean, I've been on the show. People know what's going on with me. I've been to the races. I've talked to the folks. So,
it's been neat to kind of follow along and... You know, even though I haven't been able to be...
Neat, as in, like, I'm glad I didn't have to go out there in that
sucker.
Yeah.
No, it's the that vlog style vlog thing that, you know, I kind of did out of necessity up front. It's really nice, though. You feel like you're there at the race. You get to see what's going on. And
yeah. I think
I've watched you suffer in some horrible circumstances, from freezing cold where your hands went numb to unbelievable heat. And
yep. Both have happened.
We suffer for the cause.
Yeah. Oklahoma was pretty warm. Iowa, this last one, I didn't make it to because I was in Florida, but it was warm. It was warmer in Iowa, guys, for the one race day than it was in Florida on that day.
Sheesh.
By like 3 degrees.
I saw a lot of pictures of people sweating.
Yeah, Steve had the nice rag on
his
head.
Yes, that was perfect.
Yeah. So, why don't you update everybody on what's going on with you?
I've been largely invisible because I've been working on my house.
You've been saying that for a while, though. So.
Yeah, but I've been picking at my house here and there, but this has been the concerted effort of actually finishing said house. So, we covered the whole losing the RV thing.
Right.
The windstorm and the mess that was. Adjust the camera, you. No, this is, there's no adjustment. It is a cell phone balanced on a tripod. If we touch it, it's gone.
It's falling over. This is take number two, Chad. So anyway.
So, long story short, Allstate finally paid out.
Yeah.
And I got some cash out of the deal, and we decided to throw that cash back into the house instead of buying another RV, because we made out pretty well on that deal.
Right.
Which I probably shouldn't be putting out on the interwebs. Too late.
Got the money, right?
I've got the money. So we've been making a concerted effort to get some stuff done. In fact, we got some carpet coming in for the tri-level, so for the basement level. Carpet coming in tomorrow, and then at the end of the week, I got a trim carpenter coming in to do finish up the staircase that leads upstairs. It was carpeted before. We're making it hardwood, so it matches the other flooring we put in. And we are getting ready to sell said house.
Yep. So
I'm retreating back to the great white north expanse of Indiana.
That is correct. So Doug is moving again.
Yes. I'm moving back from whence I came. Basically, kind of a series of circumstances arose, and long story short, my job is going to allow me to do my job remotely. So
from anywhere. They don't
care. They don't really care as long as the job's getting done. So we evaluated our options, and we've had a couple family meetings about it, and everybody was gung-ho to head back north. But my kids have lived there their entire life until we came down here.
Yeah.
I've lived in that area since 1984, and my parents are there, my wife's parents are there, her brothers, we got sisters, cousins. I mean, there's a lot of family that's like either right there or within, you know, a half hour, 40 minutes where family gatherings happen pretty regularly, and we found ourselves making that commute quite a bit.
Yeah.
Like, just if there was an opportunity to go up north for a holiday or a birthday, we were doing that. We were averaging, I think, $170 a trip in kenneling dogs.
Yes.
Because we've got two dogs, and they don't travel particularly well. One of them hyperventilates,
and the other one vomits.
It's not my problem because I'm not in the back seat getting puked on, but it is the kid's problem. The other side of that too is they kind of, I think I've mentioned this before, they're their own little two dog pack.
Yeah.
They don't really like other dogs, and my parents have a dog, and their dog doesn't like other dogs, so the three of them do not get along at all.
So you can't stow them with them.
No. And then my in-laws also have a dog, and he's pretty friendly with other ones, but my dogs are not friendly with him. So it's like, if they're around each other for a couple weeks, you can make it work, but for 2 days, it's just a nightmare. It's
right.
A constant just
bickering.
Yeah, so it's worse than having kids.
Right.
So we're moving back north. I mean, I'll still be in the state. We've maintained this friendship for 20-some-odd years under those circumstances.
Yep.
I mean, that, and honestly, I'll probably see about the same amount as I've seen you in recent memory anyway.
Right. So you're, to fill you guys in, Doug's job, part of the thing is he needs to come back to the main office part.
Every other week, I'll be in here for 2 days. So say like a Thursday, Friday, or a Monday, Tuesday, every other week. So just one overnight. So I'll come in, probably leave early in the morning, get down there, work, spend the night, work the next day, leave at, you know, 3 p.m, head back home, be home in time for dinner.
Yeah.
About a 3-3.5 hour drive.
Yep.
So I'll still be down here periodically, and
you'll be around.
I'll be around. Things and stuff.
Yep, stuff and things. So we should get on to UTV stuff, because
we probably should.
We have wasted time just babbling for a
this
little
is
bit.
This is a waste of time. Well, it's been a fill-in show, I've been told.
It has. So this weekend was MWXC.
Yes, it was.
I didn't make it out there because I was on 1 hour of sleep.
No cell phone reception out there either, from what I heard.
No.
I guess Verizon people, sort of, but...
Sort of, but not very much.
Not very much. This was Parker's Paradise?
It was Parker's Paradise. Rex Parker opened up his property to everybody. They had a band out there on Saturday night even. And
who got airlifted?
I don't think anybody got airlifted.
It's a Parker's Paradise miracle.
I mean, the day's not over. Well, their race day is over.
Yeah.
But
I haven't heard anything or seen anything, so that's good.
Yeah. So that's a first in a couple, 3 years that no one's been airlifted out of there.
And we say that as a joke, but honestly, we're extremely grateful because that's always scary.
Yeah. So let's see. In the pro row, that's really the only results I saw. Reynard finished first. Langford was second. Barnes was third.
Reynard has been on a tear this year.
He has.
Now, I know
Plank got fourth. Mike Plank. Good
Mike
job.
Mike Plank.
But yeah, he has.
He's always been a good driver.
He has.
But he was very infrequent. He'd show up a couple times. He was racing that Ace.
Yeah.
Back when there was no class for the single seat, and so he would just run, but he'd always be in the top three, but he'd be DQ'd because he was in an Ace.
And then he got the X3. I think he got it at the end of last year. He didn't have much seat time in it.
No.
And then now he's got some seat time in it. He is a force to be reckoned with in it.
He is. He's come on seriously strong this year. Kind of, if you know his racing history, it's not out of nowhere, but if you hadn't really competed with him before, you'd think, where the crap did this guy come from?
He did good. So, I don't know where he's at in points, but I'd say he's got to be near the top, if not the top.
So. Kevin Byers, they had an air evac.
Oh, great.
They're in case.
Oh.
Oh, that's even worse. They're so used to it, they're like, we're just going to stay here.
Just send one.
Just in case. Well, I'm glad they didn't have to use it, at least.
Yeah.
So. And it's been really fun to follow Michael Plank this year, his transition to real horsepower and a real machine. And
yeah, he's in the RS1. Now, I was thinking about that earlier because I was watching some other footage and other race starts. The RS1s, I'm not going to say they have surprised me, but they have over-exceeded my expectations of how they would perform when you throw them in with the rest of the big boys.
Well, we've talked before, though, that the turbo isn't a huge advantage in the woods.
It's not.
It is on an open track, but you get, you know, short course, you're not going to hang.
Yeah, right. The RS1 won't, no.
You just not. I mean, they're running 90-plus miles an hour in the pro mods because they've got turbos and they got the horsepower, but in the woods, there's so few places, especially in a place like Parker's Paradise, where you can actually stretch its legs. I mean, for the way we do cross-country here, I'm a little surprised that they're... But not really. I mean, it once I saw how they were doing, it just makes sense.
Yeah.
I think the offsetting advantage is sitting right in the middle, being able to see both front wheels. I think there's a little more confidence that you're not going to clip trees, mm-hmm. that you can see exactly what's going on, and that offsets the difference in power and the small advantage that power gives you.
Right.
So.
Now, a lot of the guys, you can't see the front tires because they put higher doors in them, but you're sitting in the middle, so you have a better sense of where your right front tire is versus a side-by-side where you're kind of feeling by the force where it may be up in that general vicinity.
Nothing was worse than your CF motor.
That thing was horrible. The nose on that pinched in real funny, and it's like the razors are kind of straight. The fenders are kind of straight.
Yeah.
And you can kind of guess where the front end is. The CF motor, the nose pinched in really hard.
And you took the fenders off because you were going to lose them anyways.
Yeah. And you had no idea where that right front tire was. Just zero idea. And it was super weak. In the front end anyway. So, I've just been really impressed with... I mean, They'll start the RS1s... What, are they in the third row? Is that right? At MWXC?
Mm-hmm.
And they'll be finishing in front of many of the turbos.
Yeah.
I mean, they're making up an easy minute plus on them.
Which is a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, passes are hard to come by in cross-country UTV racing.
Yeah.
And so to make up any time is just hard to do.
Yeah. So MWXC, Barry hurt his shoulder again.
Barry's younger than us, isn't he?
I think so.
Come on, man. What's up with that?
So Barry...
For the retirement home? No.
Barry hurt his shoulder initially at... Is it Iowa race? Yeah.
Yeah, it was in Iowa.
At the Iowa race. So we can...
Found a tree and ripped the wheel.
Yep.
And consequently his shoulder out of socket.
Yeah, he popped his shoulder out of socket. And then he kind of didn't help himself by racing the 4th of July thing at a local fair. So that didn't help him. And then, he hurt it again on Saturday, yesterday. So
he's going to milk this all season long.
Yeah,
he is. Well, I'm hurt.
My shoulder.
But I'm injured. That's why I didn't beat you.
Yeah.
If I was healthy.
Yeah.
Michael Plank, we should start in the first row at least once.
I
agree. I think it'd be a hoot to see all the RS1s take off first.
I agree.
And I'd be curious, with clean air and them not having to make as many passes, I'd be curious to see if any, how many turbo machines catch them.
Yeah. Barry says IXCR race is what dislocated his shoulder. He went to IXCR.
Yeah, yeah.
instead of AXCC because Barry got rid of his X3. He no longer is an X3 owner.
I'm out.
Yes, he sold it. Paul Johnson
bought
it. And I'm not going to say what he's got coming, but he's got something else coming. I'll leave it to Barry.
We can't... come on, Barry. When do we get to break the exclusive on this?
Yeah, it'll be fine. So, that's all I really know from MWXC.
Is it a double X with a Honda VTEC motor in it? It's got a spoon engine in it? Spoon engines in his double X.
No, he is not. So
I want that to be a thing now.
No, that is not a thing.
Oh, darn it. Okay.
So on to more news-ish like things. The Kawasaki KRX side-by-side. This is not new news anymore at all.
No. It looks like the Talon's cousin.
Yeah, it does.
I mean, that's not a bad thing. I don't think the Talon's a bad-looking UTV. Kawasaki definitely paid homage to it.
Yes, we'll say that. So, I'm sure most of you guys have looked at the patent drawings and the diagrams at this point. So, one thing that they did of note is they did a prototype a few years back and had some patent work then, and it was very vague, but they talked about a radius cage and on the back half, like the back legs. No, Brian, he's not going to be in YXZ.
You're in a YXZ 2020.
But they have a radius cage on the back. And they actually, now this was in the prototype one, they made the statement to help it roll back over. Probably poor choice of wording.
I'm picturing the old video, that guy that's in the mini bike with the circular cage, yes, and he'd slam on the brakes and do a circle.
Do a loop. Yeah. No, it's kind of like that, but it's not. They stayed with that radius cage on the rear legs. That's nothing amazing. They show CVT components. Okay. So it will be a CVT-driven machine.
Not going to unbuck the system there?
No, nothing amazing there. They are showing what I'm going to call a four-link, but it's not like your true four-link. They,
Kevin, CF Moto 2020. Yes, Kevin, you can race one in 2020. Go for it.
I will not be. Neither will Barry. So they are showing what's like a four-link, but it's not your traditional four-link. It has a trailing arm, much like a razor, two radius rods on the very back of the knuckle like a razor, and then a third upper forward radius rod on the front side of the knuckle.
Okay. Sounds beefy.
Yeah, we'll see. The upper radius rods I've never really known to be a super big problem on any of them.
No.
And to top that off, it's not hard to put a good radius rod, like a stronger radius rod, on them.
Like one from Spang's Fab.
Spang's Fab, check them out. And so I don't know that, maybe they have a different reasoning for it than, durability. We'll see. But that's kind of the design they had. What I find very interesting and what leaves these gaping holes in my mind is there is no patent showing for a new motor.
That is the thing that stood out to me as well, because honestly, their current stable of off-road motors, no offense, I'm going to get some Kawasaki hate, they're old. They're reliable, but it is old tech.
It is.
Very old tech. I mean, even if they try and bore it, stroke it, and freshen it up a little bit, it is going to be way behind the times.
Yes.
So maybe they're just going to pull a motor out of a Ninja and throw it in there.
They might. I mean, I suspect. So there have been rumors of Polaris motor going to a different style, more like the Can-Am, a three-cylinder, similar to that.
Hmm.
So maybe Kawasaki's going that way with something they already have.
Could be. It does seem to be the hotness.
Yeah. So that's kind of all the news on that.
Michael Plank, when's Sunny Drive going to be? Ryan Kugel, on Sunday, duh.
So, Sunday Drive, here's the update on that. I don't have the Razor. It had a transmission problem when I was going to pick it up, so it went back to CW Motorsports. They're taking care of it for me. Not a big deal. The reason we have been so late...
Sunday Drive and Chance Razor.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a little big for that. She's a big girl, and that track's tight for a 70-inch wide machine.
Yeah, it is.
So I have the whole track done. I have a mower graciously donated by Mr. Steve Mueller that I have trail mowed the track down once already. I will do it probably every time before
we start. We finally have something here that resembles dry ground.
Yes.
It's been that bad.
Like, it, you guys think, if you're not from around the area, you don't know, you know, how much rain we've had. I'm not kidding. I went out, and about every week, I would try and, if it, we've had a dry stretch, I would go out and try and drive my razor around it, which mine will fit, or I'd get the tractor out to try and do a little repair. I got the tractor stuck on the track, and it's a four-wheel drive tractor. I had to use the bucket to crawl it out.
Wow.
It was that bad.
Well, if you've heard about all the flooding over in Nebraska, Iowa, over, you know, places just over the Mississippi, we're getting that. It's just kind of starting to peter out, but all those storm systems,
they're still hitting us.
We're getting them as well. So it's been just out and out terrible. In fact, I found a couple roof leaks. You know, yeah. You know the stuff you find when you're going to sell your house? It's just plumbing snacks, like,
yeah,
seal around them, no big deal, but you start finding that stuff when it rains every single day.
You're very right.
It's like Florida.
So I have a date set for the first round of Sunday Drive. I'm not going to say what date. I've talked to a few people who are going to be there. If you didn't get invited, I'm sorry. You will be invited. If you
you didn't get invited, send checks too.
Yeah. No. We're just, I can't do everybody all at once. You guys all understand that, I'm very sure. It'd just be way too many people.
Wait, I didn't get invited.
Like I said. So it'd just be way too many people to have run the track that day and be able to get times and everything else. It'd just take way too long. So we're going to do a few rounds of it. I will get everybody in who wants to be in. I mean, yep. If I have to do this and we're doing it in the winter, we will keep going. So, yeah, it could be like, you know,
if it gets cold enough, we can reroute part of the track over the pond.
Over the pond, there you go. So we're let's see, what are we? About 3 weeks from filming. A little less.
Today is the 7th.
Yeah.
So
about 3 weeks.
Do the math.
So anyway,
production time's going to take a little while on this because it's going to be a very different kind of show.
I will try and get the first episode out as quickly as possible. We will update you guys with more when we have it. And, yeah.
Spectators allowed, question mark. Did we get the coloring book / liability waivers out yet?
Not yet. Message me, Kevin.
Yeah.
We'll see what we can figure out. Yeah. We're not going to have a bunch of people.
The blanket rule is going to be no, but we will probably make some exceptions for some people that we know.
Yeah.
But we can't have 60, 70 people show up. It's just going to be a mess.
And honestly, it wouldn't be all that entertaining. I mean, it would be okay for everybody hanging out, but to see the race, it's like any XC race. You'd see a brief glimpse of them go by.
Yeah, and we're going to be filming, and there's going to have to be reshoots of certain things. I mean, the laps will be live, but yeah, it's...
Right. So, yeah, that's the plan. We have a date set for the first filming of it. I'm going to cram as many people as I think I can get filmed in on those days as possible. If I see that I can get more in, I will go with more on each subsequent filming day.
We're just going to, I mean, it's a brand new thing. We got to have a test run.
Yep. So that's that. I'm really still looking forward to it. I so thought we would have had the first episodes filmed and out by now. If you went back and talked to me of 6 months ago, I was like, oh yeah, we're deep into it now. We filmed several go-rounds, and we've got episodes coming out, and blah, 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 blah.
This year...
We haven't had the weather.
It's been a mess.
There's nothing I mean, you guys that are racers, you've seen it. It's a spectator / camera operator. Yes.
Yes, bring a camera and some skill.
Yeah.
We could use that.
So... Yeah, we just had way too much weather.
Well, I just fixed those potholes in my gravel driveway.
Yeah.
I actually have a complete washout in part of it now. There's been so much rain, it has cut a channel down the long part of my driveway, and now I have to go fix that.
Yeah, it's been great.
Yeah, perfect.
So, let's see.
Are you going to have an aim system for the track cars? No, what we are going to have is razor blades at arm height, so if you start cutting too wide, they're going to come in the cab and charge you.
they're on little twigs that flick in and get you.
Yeah. We're not going to cut our own tires, but we will cut your arms up.
Yeah. No. The track will be well arrowed and marked, as stated before. It is not...
Can I dust off my race start speech?
You can. Do you want to do that?
I could.
So the track is not going to be a what we'll call quote-unquote challenging track. It is a track that people can put down consistent lap times.
That was really our goal. I mean, there's going to be some challenge there. You have to know what you're doing in a UTV, but it's not designed to be super
It's not designed
technical.
To test your skill.
No. It's designed for... You should be able to put down consistent lap times. So if you consistently run the same time and somebody's faster than you, that just means they're faster than you.
Right. That's how it is. So... Yeah, that's kind of where we're at. Let's see.
The Can-Am 2020 X3.
Yes, they've gone to 195 horse.
More horsepowers. So that means they told some guy in the lab, hey, get your laptop out. Turn this thing up a little bit.
No, they actually went for a... Yeah, they have a bigger turbo, intercooler that's bigger, and a few other little things like that. They legitimately bumped some things up.
It didn't take them much to get there, though.
No, it did not.
I mean, this was not like some sort of weird clean sheet of paper. They literally just bolted on a few aftermarket parts that other people were basically doing already.
Right. So, kind of the way that all of them are now, if it's a RR model, it is capable of having 195 horsepower.
Yes.
And Can-Am is still using all their RRRSDXS whatever...
Alphabet X3, soup.
Yes, alphabet soup of things. So it's kind of a nightmare. But if it has the RR, it is 195 horsepower. There is only one model that is 64 inches, and it is their quote-unquote base model. I mean, yeah. That's what it's being called. But it's like the X3 DS RR or whatever it is.
And the low-end turbo horsepower remains unchanged. It still has the old turbo. It has the old intercooler. There's nothing changed there.
But they go... 64 inches, which is what they call 64 inches, but it's like my Razor and all the others are. It's 64 inches of full droop. It's more like 67 inches wide. And then they have 72 inches wide, and then they have a 74-inch wide model also.
There you go.
And the 74-inch wide model is at full droop, too.
Wow.
You're touching like 76, 77 inches?
That is
that.
A bus. Holy cow.
Yeah. So... That's exciting.
Chad, check phone. We can't. We're recording on
it. Recording on it. How am I supposed to do that?
Brandy, text me. I have my phone here.
Yeah, there you go. So that's kind of what's going on with the X3s.
I am curious. It's a bigger turbo, and I'm sure they've sorted this all out. But I'm curious. Bigger turbo typically means a little bit more lag because it takes time to spool. So I'm just curious if it'll be a noticeable thing or not. My guess is probably not, but the nerd in me always wonders.
Yeah.
If it's more mass, it's bigger than...
My wife wants to know if I want dinner. Yes, I will take dinner. Thank you.
Look at that. Bring pie.
Doug wants pie.
Don't care what kind. Pie's good.
So let's see. You know what we haven't done, and it's going to take a few minutes, Ryan Kunkel.
Yes. What are we having? You guys are having whatever's in, you know, the Salisbury steak that's been in the back of your freezer for 3 years. That's probably what you're having.
Yeah. So, we haven't done trivia yet. We haven't started trivia, and we are going to try trivia via live.
So this is going to be delayed because...
It takes a minute for you all to answer.
Yeah. So we're going to try do it... Oh, yeah.
I got to do... So trivia for you guys is on my phone.
It's on his phone.
My phone's over there that's recording us.
This is gold.
So, here's what I'm going to do.
Well, do you want my phone? Can you get...
Now.
Okay.
You just won't answer trivia, Douglas. You will be asking the questions with everyone.
I can promise that I won't look at the answers. I can't promise that. So, yeah, there's been some interesting developments out there. I'm really curious about this Kawasaki. Of all the news, you know, there's been the mild Can-Am updates. There's been some talk at the players' camp about a few different things. Nothing really from, you know, Wildcat XX type of stuff. But I really am interested in this Kawasaki. I
want to see, because they've stuck with that Terex for so long and made no changes, really.
And there's no patent on a motor, so that means they're either buying the motors from somebody else or they're just going to shove a real turd in it.
Right.
Or they've got some super secret-y thing.
Okay, all right. So trivia. There are ground rules, and we're just going to have to trust that all you guys are going to be fair and honest about everything, because we have no way of policing you. But Barry
Miller
right.
Hit it on the head. No Googling.
No Googling. This is all on the honor system of can you answer this?
And we all know you to be honorable people.
Yes. So, yeah, because none of you cut
no
the tracks at all or anything crazy. No. So, here's what we're going to do. We're going to ask you the question, and we'll just basically run through all of them in a reasonable way, and then we'll come back and give you all answers. So what we want you guys to do is type your answer in the comments so that we have a record of it.
No Ask Jeeves, no Bing.
No.
If you can find a copy of Alta Vista, you can use that.
If you can... If you want to go back and find all your old encyclopedias on the shelf, the paper versions,
yeah,
you can use those.
Yeah. You're ruining the fun, people. All right. So the first question. The fastest black hole moving through space currently is moving how fast? So in terms of, this one is in miles per hour. I'll give you that much.
Yes.
If you want to answer in meters per second, I will do a conversion, but...
I won't. I will say, you're just wrong.
Okay.
It's a 4th of July weekend.
Miles per hour.
So, yes, the fastest black hole moving through space, how fast is it currently moving at?
So, while they're answering that, speaking of 4th of July weekend...
Yes.
I did an amazing fireworks display.
Did you?
Had some fun this year. So normally we'd spend a fair amount on fireworks, but it was, it's not 12, Steve. We would, you'd buy the mortars and it comes with one tube, so you drop a mortar in and light it, and boom, does its thing, and then you run up there and you drop another one.
You ever look in the hole?
After it's lit? I almost did one year because I lit one.
And it didn't go.
And I wait, and then the smoke starts dissipating, and I'm like, okay, the fuse went out. And I waited another 30 seconds after I thought, okay, it's surely out.
Yeah.
I get up close to it, and right as I'm like, the tube is here, and I'm just starting to do this, poof. I was not a happy camper.
All right. So, on with your... Well, okay, we'll let that... We'll just keep telling the story.
So, actually, here's what we'll do. I'll interject the next question. You can start answering that. What?
Yeah. So... We're going to give the answer now?
I think enough people answered. We'll continue that.
So the fastest black hole that is currently moving through space is going 3 million miles an hour.
That's a lot of kilometers per hour.
Yes. Who was it? Kevin Byers was the closest at 1 million.
1 million.
Miles per hour. But you're one-third or two-thirds off.
Yeah.
So.
5,000 miles per hour. No.
Very slow.
No. That would be if Kawasaki made it. Okay, so question two. The moon drifts away from the Earth how much every year? So the moon, just like you on a bad date in high school, is constantly trying to get away.
Yes. But you can't.
But you can't. Gravity keeps pulling you back. Probably because you've dated a very large girl.
Gravity's pulling you back to that one.
So the moon is drifting away.
From the Earth.
From the Earth how much every year?
How much does the Earth drift away? It is in centimeters. So
yes.
Give us an answer in centimeters. Put it in the comments. On with your story. You did a great...
So this year we went down to the fireworks place and I loaded up on...
Joe's discount fireworks.
If I want to start a fireworks stand and have some guy that's got like three missing fingers and a missing eye and a big scar and like burns on his arm to run the place.
Like the Black Panther tattooed on
yes,
the forearm.
Yes, exactly.
Not like the...
No, the black cat.
The black cat, that's
yes,
what it is.
From the fireworks.
Yeah, not like the race group.
Yes. That would be awesome. So, a scooch. Yes, a skosh.
Skosh.
A skosh. I like that answer.
Okay.
Ooh, we're getting some good answers
here. We are getting some good answers here.
I think we're going to give this one more second for one more answer here.
Yeah. So I'll...
Because we haven't seen anything from...
Mr. Mueller.
Or Mr. Mueller.
He's probably
He's furiously Googling right now. Ooh.
Steve's probably flipping through the pages of his encyclopedia collection frantically trying to find it.
All right, we're going to throw it out there now. So the moon drifts away from the Earth how many... How much? How many centimeters every year? And the answer is Four. So we had, Matt Lithgow had 3, and Mike Plank had 5 inches. I thought we had another one that was close.
It probably rolled off.
Nope. I saw the 5, but it was inches. Sorry. So,
Matt Lithgow
wins 3 centimeters.
I like
Brad's answer, 42, because that is the answer to life, the universe, and everything.
42. All right, question number 3, and then we'll go on with Doug's story. What is odd about a hippo's sweat?
I mean, other than the fact that I didn't think they sweat.
They do.
Wow.
But they kind of live in the water, so they don't sweat.
Well, and their skin's like 4 feet thick. Like, how does it make it out?
Barry says skosh equals 4 centimeters. Lies.
Remember that when he wants to adjust your toe in the skosh.
Yeah.
Hey, your primary is a little... Let me just adjust that in a skosh for you.
Yeah. So question number 3 is, what's odd about a hippo's sweat? Go ahead and put those answers in the comment. Doug, on with your story of fire workings.
So I buy the, you know, they got the cakes that have the tubes in there. You light them once and a bunch of them go up. And I bought some big fountains, and I bought a couple of really big, like, finale cakes.
Okay.
You know, that they're like shoot out at different angles. And,
yeah.
And I bought a bunch of candy fuse. And I actually had this thing all set up. I got my dad had a couple pieces of cement board.
Okay.
And so I had it all, actually it was on one big piece of cement board, and I had some of the bigger cakes sitting off to the side. And I took the slow fuse, which burns about an inch a second, give or take. It's a little less than that, because it's like 10 inches per, I don't know, whatever. But it's basically, yeah, it's a little less than a foot every 10 seconds, whatever it is. About an inch. So anyways, I lead it through. And I just do this big, like, serpentine up and down, you know, lazy curve up and down, up and down, up and down. And then I had a bunch of fast fuse, which burns, like, 10 inches a second.
Okay.
So, I mean...
That's the fun stuff.
You light that stuff, and it just is gone.
That's the stuff you tie to the cat's tail.
Exactly. And if you just light it on the ground, it actually, like, goes flying off, because it burns so quick.
It's propelling itself?
Yes.
Okay.
So, I had that big, lazy curve, and then I started going, okay, well, my hand span from here to here... If I, like, kind of do this, if I don't really stretch it, if I just kind of leave it relaxed, it's about 8 inches.
Yep.
And so I'm like, okay, that's 8 seconds, 16, 24. This should last about 20 and change. So I started spacing them all out. And then I would take the fast fuse and go off of the slow fuse to light the firework. And so I had this whole really ornate thing set up, and it was freaking amazing.
Oh, yeah.
And we didn't have any ground bursts either. Like, nothing caught something else on fire that exploded early.
Well, that's no fun.
It all went off perfectly, and, like, neighbors were coming out. Because there's other neighbors in the neighborhood lighting off onesie-twosie stuff. Like, all the other ones stopped, and people were, like, walking down the street to see what's going on. The cool part was the neighbors had 2 little girls, and they had to go to work the next day. The adults had to go to work the next day. And so they didn't want to take them out, because then... They don't start fire. It's like 10:30 at night.
Yeah.
You know, it's got to be dark. And by the time you get home, it's like midnight. So they were worried they weren't going to get to see anything. And so they came out and had their girls out with them and were watching the whole thing. And the guy's like, that is the best, like, non-professional show I've ever seen in my life.
There you go.
It was really, really cool. So next year is going to be even bigger. Yeah. I've got the taste for automation now. Next year is going to be insane. Like, I'm going to build... Well, we'll get to that.
So the answer to question number 3... What is odd about a hippo's sweat? Matt Lithgow is amazingly close.
I think Matt Lithgow's cheating.
He might be. But the hippo's sweat is red. It looks very similar to blood.
Like Kevin Myers. It smells. I have no clue other than it may not be a liquid.
Yeah.
But it's like shooting out like crystals.
Crystals.
Ow.
Yeah. All right. Question number 4.
How old does a porcupine have to be for its needles to become dangerous? So when they're little...
Like when they're inside their mother's womb?
Could you imagine trying to push it out and it's like...
ka-ching, ka-ching, inside the mother porcupine?
Yes. So they're kind of cute and cuddly when they're, you know, first born. But how long until they're lethal? Well, not lethal.
Not lethal.
Just annoying.
Yeah. Pokey.
Pokey.
How long until the needles... on a baby porcupine become pokey?
These are actually good questions for once.
Hey, don't act surprised.
I'm totally surprised. You think they're junk.
Thank you.
So, Next year I'm kind of planning on, I want to mix some more mortars in, but they give you the one cardboard too, but I'm going to get some Schedule 80 PVC and make some
cannons. That's supposed to be dangerous. Like, yeah. PVC will blow up.
Well, I figure if a cardboard tube will stand up to it. The key is you can't size it so that, like, the mortar, like, you're packing it in right there, because now it's a pipe bomb.
Glue a cap on.
Pipe bombs for everyone! So
I would set it up, glue all the caps on, have like 40 of them.
Well,
boom!
Set it to music. Shrapnel, everyone's like screaming. Well, maybe I won't use... I was going to use Schedule 80 PVC. Maybe I'll just find some thick wall cardboard. But I want to have a, you know, some cannons set up that I can integrate into the mix. And
yeah.
I've even thought about doing something super nerdy. Ooh, we got answers.
We do.
Okay, that's enough. How old does a porcupine have to be for its needles to become dangerous? 30 minutes.
30 minutes.
Yeah. That is amazing. So basically, like...
I don't know if it's like the fluid inside of... Like, keeps them soft and not pokey.
If you get a porcupine wet, are they not pokey?
I think they're still pokey. Like, no. I think once...
I'm not going to, like, go hug one and find out.
Once they become pokey... They are pokey.
Well, the other thing people don't realize is they can launch those suckers.
Yeah.
Like...
Not all of them, but some.
Yeah.
Yeah. They will stab you.
Question five. What... nobody was really close. I guess the closest was Brad.
Yeah.
2 weeks. Okay. What will a male llama do to other male llamas during mating season to get rid of the competition? Okay. So...
This is more in line with your normal...
This is what I was expecting.
Okay. So, yeah. What will...
I meant 30 minutes, damn autocorrect. yeah, so I've even thought about getting really, really super nerdy with it. So, you know, the Raspberry Pi,
yes.
They have the GPIO header that you could use to... Like, you can send a pin high, which could then trigger... They've got the auxiliary board that plugs in that has relays and stuff.
Right.
So you can, through programming, tell it close a relay, yada, yada, yada.
Yeah.
I was like, I could have it close a relay, activate a high voltage supply that would light the fuse, and I literally can kick the whole show off, just
go. Yeah.
That might happen because I've got several of them that are just gathering dust on the shelf, so that might have to happen.
Michael Plank says he mounts it. The one llama will mount the other llama.
It would scare me off.
So
Nobody else
is guessing. They saw the look on your face, and they're like, I don't know about that.
If this was Facebook, well, it is Facebook, but if I could do a little emoji thing, it would be the wow one.
Yeah.
Spits in its competition.
I think llamas do that all to everybody.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
They're crazy accurate, too.
Yeah.
I mean, they can get some distance and some real accuracy on a loogie.
Yep.
Llama loogies.
Dab. Right, since they dab. Okay, we'll go ahead and answer this one. If you guys have any last-minute ones, throw them in there.
But this is actually something, if you have competition at a bar...
It also works.
You could do this as well yourself.
Yes.
The answer is they bite off the opposing male's testicles.
Yes.
Or they attempt to.
Yes. That may get you kicked out of a bar before you get the task accomplished, but...
It's not the craziest thing I think I've ever heard of in a bar, so...
Yeah.
Question six. Is there a word on the Liberty Bell that is misspelled?
No, there
is. Oh, there is.
There is a word on the Liberty Bell that is misspelled. What word is misspelled?
That's awesome.
So
maybe they just spelled it back, different back then?
Not that I found.
So do you remember the old Snickers commercials, the like not going anywhere commercials? They run them during sporting events?
Yeah.
And so there's the guy out there, and he's airbrushing the end zone.
Yeah.
You know, because the home team has their name in the end zone.
Right.
So he's out there airbrushing, and he shows them, like, taking a brush and, like, being super detailed. He's out there all day. And so this, you know, it's Kansas City. And so a player runs up at the end. He's standing there looking at it. Player runs up next to me and goes, that's great. Who are the chefs?
So.
Well, and it's cracked, so... I mean, whoever made that bell just did not do a very good job.
So, fun other little fact about the Liberty Bell. It was originally cast for a price of, they're saying, $225. That's what it costs to have made.
That's a lot of bronze.
Well, back then, that was a lot of money.
I know, but that's still, that's surprisingly cheap. I would have figured like a couple thousand or something. Well, that was all still done using the lost wax techniques. You had to make the wax molds and pour it in and melt the wax out.
Yeah.
I mean, that was...
Yeah.
Obviously, it didn't quite work, but... Bell. I don't think the Liberty Bell actually has Bell written on it.
It might.
I don't think it does.
I don't know.
I'm pretty sure it does not.
So...
We have a correct answer.
I think we should just give them the answer and we'll move on.
Yes, Ryan Kunkel is correct.
Pennsylvania
is spelled with one...
It's one N.
Well, yeah. One N in the front part of it.
Yeah. The pen in Pennsylvania is spelled with one N on the Liberty Bell. They misspelled it.
The...
Yeah.
T-t-he? Okay, so the longest ray, question 7, the longest ray on the Statue of Liberty's crown is how long?
So the part we're talking about, you know, the crown... The, I don't know. I call it a crown. I don't know.
Headpiece.
Yeah. The headpiece on the Statue of Liberty is, you know, around there. And then it's got, like, the pointy bits that go out. These are the official descriptors used going out. How long is the longest one?
How long are the spiky things coming out of her head?
Yes. So it is in...
Okay. I just saw Ryan's comment from the testicle biting question. Did someone call Jason Punch?
I saw that, yes. I was ignoring that one.
I'm not ignoring that. I'm throwing it out there. 76 feet. Wow.
Okay, that's an answer.
She's a bigger statue than I thought.
She's a big girl, and she likes to party.
Cause she's, what, 120-some-odd feet tall, I think?
Something like that. It's not as tall as a lot of people think.
No. Trust me, it's a big statue, but it's not, like, Empire State Building challenging
right.
Tall. Yeah.
So, we're getting some answers in here.
Dude, Matt Lithgow is coming up with some very good answers.
It's an educated man.
That is a very educated man.
So, all right.
Brad, 42 feet. Yes.
Other Brad. 24 feet. They're just opposite of each other, both Brads.
Yes, they are. The answer is 9 feet, so Matt Lithgow takes it one more time for being closest, although we don't give points for close. Trust me, I know.
Yeah.
3 or 6 feet, I mean.
Sure.
Or 9.
So, bonus question, where is the Statue of Liberty located?
Which state is it in? It's Ellis Island, we all know that.
Yep.
Which state is that in?
I have bonus questions for the rest of them on out, so we'll ask the bonus question at the same time.
Oh,
as the
yes, we probably
I forgot about
that.
But that'll save us a little bit of time.
Yeah, nobody's got anywhere to be anyways.
No, not really.
Haven't it wasted, I don't know, a lot, what, 37? Yeah.
We're approaching our time.
90-minute shows are not like a totally abnormal thing
right.
For us either.
So we do also want to say congratulations to Matt Rowell and his girlfriend, Jessica. His Jessica girlfriend.
His Jessica. You can say his Jessica.
That'll work. They are expecting a baby, so congratulations, guys.
Yes, congratulations.
I'm sure you'll both make great parents, you know.
And now, in a few years, when he's out there racing AXCC, he's going to have one in the, they don't call it Pee-wees, but...
Yeah, I don't know what they call it.
Is it Junior, or is that the 570s?
I think they call the Juniors 570. No, they call them Youth.
Youth. Maybe it is Juniors, then.
I think it is called Juniors.
Okay. Well, there you go. The little 170s. The go-karts.
Yes.
Texas? Question mark. Thanks, Ryan. Ooh.
Okay, we'll just go ahead and call it now.
Yeah, Kevin Byers, look at you.
Good job.
New Jersey. However, it is not an Ellis Island. It's Liberty Island.
Liberty Island, yes, he is right.
I was deliberately throwing you off.
Ellis Island is, that's the one where
that's the port of entry.
The immigration.
Yeah, that's yes. The port of entry. I was trying to throw them off, but he was not having it. Massachusetts, D.C. No, you're all wrong.
It is in New Jersey.
It is in New Jersey.
All right, question number 8.
What building is the largest office building in the world? And...
We can't...
I would have gotten this one.
We can't tell them that one, though, because then they'll know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll wait.
Well, we could ask it this way. So this is a very large building, and it has...
All of Steve's comments are just now coming through for some strange reason. all of his answers to all of the questions are just now coming through.
All of a sudden, all we see, it must have been coming through. 1.6 inches, Pennsylvania.
93,000 miles. Steve, you're really slow with that encyclopedia.
What the crap? Yes, Steve, what the crap?
I was sitting there thinking, we haven't seen Steve comment in a while. Normally, he's very commenty.
So we are looking at the we need the answer of the largest office building in the world, and I would have gotten this one. So as a lot of large buildings, they have a kind of a plaza area, you know, like a large centralized area. How big is that area?
In this building.
In this particular building.
And that you can guess without even knowing the building.
Yeah.
You can just give it... just give us in acres.
Yes. Give you an idea of how big this building is.
Yep. Yes, Kevin Byers said that Steve's comments just came through due to Central Time. Illinois.
Is that how time zones work?
Obviously, Steve had not paid his taxes on his Facebook. So, Illinois is taxing that now.
Well, his internet out there is not awesome either.
Yeah. Oh, I like Ryan Kunkel's answer, although I'm sorry, Ryan, it's not right. Last minute world headquarters.
Bank of America.
We're getting some, those are the bonus questions we're getting. Hancock at 8 acres.
It's a reasonable guess.
80 acres. Is,
wow.
That'd be a big courtyard area.
Yes, that would. Well, if the answer actually is LMM, then that's... probably about right.
Yeah, that'd probably be right. Okay, I'd say we can give them an answer now. So the largest office building in the entire world is the Pentagon.
Ta-da!
It has 17 miles of corridors running in it. There are 5 what they call rings in each level. So like there's the outermost radius of it, and that's a ring around with offices on sides and open rooms and stuff. Then another ring, the next row in with offices and sides, and there's 5 of those going in.
In a 5-acre central plaza.
Yes, 5 acres in the center of it.
It's actually not just the largest office building in the world, it's the largest building in the world, period.
Yeah, it's pretty big.
Yeah.
So Brad was the closest, definitely with the bonus one, at 6 acres.
Yes, Brad Mapes.
Mapes.
Not Ashby, sorry.
Question
number 9, we're getting down here. The boardwalk in Atlantic City was built in 1870.
That's not a question, that's a statement. But yes, I was just giving information.
Which you normally don't, so I appreciate that.
Yes.
How long was it when it was built?
So, yes, and I put and when it was built because it has changed sizes from when it was built until now. So if you went there now and measured it, it would be much different.
Bonus question, why was it built?
Yes, why was the boardwalk originally built?
Ta-da! Michael Plank, I was in the closet with the... I was the closest with the actual building. But as we all know...
Closest only counts in horseshoes and hand grenades.
It does not count here because I've been close many times and you've never been...
No imaginary internet points for you.
No.
So... let's see, what else do we have going on?
I was looking at some of the other info that we didn't put up there from the Pentagon. 17 miles of corridors built in 1943 for $83 million, which seems remarkably cheap.
Which would be today, $1.3 billion.
But I would be willing to bet you can't build that building for $1.32 billion today. Like, that's adjusted for inflation. I'll bet you can't build that building for that.
You might be. It's only 5 stories high.
It goes down.
It's 5 stories above ground, 5 stories below.
That's what they want you to think. Well, it's like the courthouse I used to work in. It was built in 1903, and they gave the cost. If you adjust it for inflation, it was yada, yada, yada. But you couldn't rebuild it for that because it's all
hand
marble. It's all marble, and it's got mosaic tile inlays and yada, yada, yada. Like, you couldn't just adjust for inflation. It doesn't cover it.
Right. Okay, so we have a fair amount of answers up, so we'll go ahead and give the answer to question number 9. We're on 9. Question number 9. So, the boardwalk in Atlantic City, how long was it when it was built?
Seven miles.
It was 7 miles long.
You guys need to tell better fish stories.
Yes. And how long is it now, Douglas?
It is 4.5 miles long because storms keep nibbling away
part
of it.
Yep, one big storm destroyed part of it, so now they're kind of maintaining it at the 4.5 mile length.
When it kind of outlived its original purpose, which was the bonus question.
The bonus question of, yep.
And it was built to stop people from tracking sand into the hotels and trains.
Yes.
Which I love.
Because people would get off the beach there and go into the hotels and there would just be trails of sand. And sand is really hard on carpets. Have you ever seen?
Yeah.
Like when mass amounts of sand gets tracked into carpets, it just grinds it and tears the pile from the bottom. Yeah. So.
All right, last question.
Question number 10.
What percent of land in the U.S. is owned by the government? And the bonus, the state of Nevada has the most land that is owned by the government by percentage. And what percentage is that? So we're looking for a percentage that the government owns of the U.S. as a whole.
Yes.
That's government-owned land. And then specific to Nevada, which has the highest percentage, what is the percentage of government-owned land?
In Nevada.
Now this... We're talking state and federal, so
right.
Like, we're not going to split hairs about that. This is just non-privately owned land. My personal thought is, too dang much.
Yes. Although, there's part of me that thinks it's kind of nice, because you can normally ride, especially when you get out west, you can ride on government land.
I do like that, and that's one thing we don't have here in Indiana, is that almost everything is owned
privately.
Like, you can't just go ride on stuff, unless you know the farmer or whatever.
Yeah, very little is government-owned, and the stuff that is government-owned, because there's so little of it, very, very little is of even the government land is rideable.
Yeah.
Michigan is kind of the opposite, though. I mean, they still, a lot of it is not government-owned, like a majority of it is not.
No.
But they do have a bunch of trails up in Michigan that are...
Well, the DNR has a lot more influence up there, so they have a lot more easements on, okay, this is technically your land, however, you know.
Right.
But tourism is really the driving force in Michigan. I mean, that's where they make most of their money. They have lakes all around, they have beaches everywhere, and they build themselves as an outdoor...
Because Lord knows we aren't going to downtown Detroit to sightsee.
Depends on the kind of sights you want to see.
Yeah. I want to see a shooting.
I like homeless people.
Yeah. Lots of them.
Ain't nobody going downtown Detroit to see the Lions play, that's for sure.
Yeah.
All right. Ooh, we got some solid answers coming in.
We do. I think Steve's internet is giving him fits again. Here in about an hour, I'm going to get Steve's comments. It's just going to be just hammering away at it. So, you think we got enough to go ahead and give him?
I think we do. So, the answer, a lot of you were pretty close on this. The government and states combined own about 32% of the United States landmass. So Ryan said 30, Kevin Byer said 37%, Matt Lithgow said 30. A lot of you guys close on that. Nevada, 84.5% owned
by
the government, which is staggeringly high. However, if you've ever been to Nevada, most of it is useless desert.
Right. That's the best spot for the government to have, because they're useless, too.
Yes, exactly.
Sorry, did I say that loud?
Maybe. I gave up. My answers aren't coming through. But your inane text is...
Yeah.
Has nothing to do with this. Okay.
It's fine.
But
he wasn't wrong.
But he wasn't wrong. Matt Lithgow, 65. Kevin Byers, 57. 64. I think Lithgow's... Probably the winner again. He's the closest on both, 30 and 65. It's 32 and 85. Or
Michael Plank said 64, so he was close. Yep.
You guys were amazingly close. However, no good, sorry.
So.
Looking at all of these, I would have gotten... I definitely would have gotten the Pentagon one.
I figured you would have.
I would have gotten the Liberty Bell one.
Would you?
Yep. And I'm not going to lie. The 4 centimeters on the moon thing, like I know it now that I see, like, yes, I've heard that before, but I think if you asked me in a vacuum 30 minutes ago, no.
No.
So okay. Probably 2 for 10. The other guesses would have been, like, I probably would have been in the ballpark on the land. But
Yeah.
There you go.
So, all right, guys, we are over the 1 hour mark, but, That's all you can
see. Live television. What are you going to do?
Not like there's any editing of the normal ones.
And when you bring me on the show, I tend to add a certain amount of puckiness.
Sarah Plank's at 64. Oh, on the land guess.
Oh, okay. Percentage. I was like, huh? Good for you. 64. 32.
All right. Well, you want to do the sponsors thing since you haven't done it in a while?
We do want to say thank you to our title sponsor, CW Motorsports, who has been so good to us this year and is still working hard to get that.
Well, they got it fixed.
They got their razor together.
Yeah.
But they've been amazing about that whole thing. So we really appreciate you guys. Bangs Fab, we shouted out to them earlier. They really do make some outstanding parts. And if you are looking to upgrade or replace broken, that should be your first stop. And if you need a full race cage or anything pretty much to make your UTV an absolute beast out there, Spinning's Fab is the place to stop and do that.
Yep.
TGM Off-Road, just a great all-around group of guys and gals who like to ride, who support each other, who really like to eat. If you need food recipes,
they are it.
You can't figure out what to make next week because you're bored of all your old recipes, literally just go to TGM Off-Road on Facebook, and you'll find a couple posts about UTVs. And you'll
Did
find
you know, 50 this is off-topic, but on-topic. Some of those guys even have, it's called a muff pot, and you put it around your header pipe or your muffler, and it cooks your food while you're riding.
Yeah.
I didn't know that that was a thing.
Yeah.
I was like, that's amazing.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Especially if you want to, like, sear a steak, that red hot turbo, you could just...
Yeah, just...
So, yeah.
Just a quarter mile runs on each side, please.
And they've got, usually in September,
they ride the Ride Royal Blue ride.
So, coming up sometime in the next few months, you might want to start making plans for that. In fact, if you haven't started making plans, you probably should. We've also got Watch Communications, who is still blindly hosting this mess. I don't think they've ever actually watched a show, and that's why they're hosting.
Tell them.
Yes. So
they're better not knowing.
Yes. They've been through a management change even recently, and they're still willing to host this.
Tell them anything.
No. But we really, really do appreciate that as well. And, of course, we've got... who else? Who am I forgetting?
I don't know. Who have you gone through?
So we've got...
CW Motorsports, Fangs Fab, TGM Off-Road, Watch Communications.
Yep.
That's it. Maybe.
Why do I feel like I'm forgetting?
I don't know. Maybe.
Is there another one out there?
My wallet.
My wallet. Chad's wallet. We do appreciate that very, very much. And we be looking out for announcements because we are going to be doing... Yeah.
Sunday Drive.
It's coming up fast.
Races coming up. Not racists. Races.
Well, probably some of both.
Yeah. Casey, Illinois is coming up for AXCC here soon. And then the Heartland Challenge is coming up here soon.
Which unfortunately is on top of the Lithgow wedding.
Matt, just push it a week.
She's got the rest of her life with you. It doesn't really matter.
Matt, let put it to her this way. I'm good at this kind of stuff. Tell her that you love her so much that you want to get married now so that you can spend more of your life with her. And just go to like
it. That is genius.
See, it works. Just do it. Go.
Powder Puff Race.
Oh, Powder Puff Race at Extreme. That is in September, I think. Is that right? You guys tell me the date. I don't have it in front of me. But they are doing a Powder Puff Race, so the women get to race the side-by-sides.
Ooh. Vegas trip. yeah, no. So, yeah, good stuff coming up.
Yeah.
I'm going to be in and out, and I mean, dude, you want me to be on the show, I'm on the internet. Jump away.
Yeah.
And I'll be here every other week and yada, yada, yada. So
you never know.
I'll still be in the picture probably more than I have been because I've been trying to get this stupid
house done.
But we're on the cusp. This week is it. It gets listed.
And then hopefully collect money quickly and move on.
Move on with my life.
Yep.
To the next thing that I'll butcher.
So, yep. That's all we got for you. We're going to go ahead and get out of here. So this is kind of different. It's on Facebook. I am going to upload it to YouTube. So still... Down below, you will see a like and subscribe and an alert thing. The alert is the bell. The subscribe is the one that's labeled subscribe.
Please do those things.
So, go ahead and do that. That helps. Leave comments, likes, share this to your friends. If you guys want to see more live stuff like this, definitely let us know. And we'll try and work it in. It's not something we can do all the time, but we'll do them when we can. So,
things and stuff.
Yeah, that's what we got. And, you know what? We haven't done a stupid thing with Chad in a while. And although this one is not about me, It is about my son.
Okay.
And it happened in Florida, and it was funny.
Okay.
So we pull in the truck. We had gone somewhere, and he's sitting in the back seat, and he like starts to get out. He's like, "I'm not getting out." I'm like, "Why are you not getting out?" He goes, "You see the size of this mosquito out there?" And I like turn around and look in the back. It's a dragonfly. Dude, that ain't a mosquito.
Can you imagine if it was? That'd suck you dry.
Yeah. So he does not know his animal kingdom.
Has he ever been in the big outdoor room?
No, not much. He didn't know the difference between the dragonfly and the mosquito.
That is a special thing.
I also found out he does not do well with escalators. Like, he's scared of them. My wife had to, like, push him onto the escalator. I don't know if he thinks he's going to be sucked in.
He's too big to be sucked in.
That's what I told him. I said that exact thing. It's like, you're like 6'5". You're too big to be sucked into the escalator. So
I wish I could have been on this trip. It sounds like the trip of discovery.
It was interesting. So, no matter how big you think mosquitoes are.
And no matter what escalator you've been sucked down into.
Yep.
Thanks for riding along with us.
Thanks, guys. And now you get to watch us get up and turn the video off.
Tired of screwing up, tired of going down, tired of myself, tired of this town.